Good afternoon. Thank you for coming to today's Academic Affairs Faculty Forum. This is a couple of times semesters we get together and talk about things academic. Today the focus of the discussion is on research and graduate education. Last time we had discussed this topic was in March of 2014. At that time we proposed ways for reorganizing the sort of structure of research and graduate education, and got some feedback. We moved ahead with that plan, which went into effect in that following July 1st. So today, Vice President and Dean of Graduate Studies, Carol Kim, will talk through some of the ways of, things have changed, some of the new initiatives that are ongoing, and some of the things we see for future directions. Just like we did last time we had an Academic Affairs Faculty Forum, I'll take the last part of it, a half hour or so, and update you as best I can on what's going on with the One University things, with the University Main System. The focus will be on what's going on in academics, of academic transformation. So that's the plan for this afternoon. Without further ado, Vice President Kim.
Thank you, Jeff. Filled in here. So good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for joining us to discuss our progress in the past year in research and graduate studies. And so we've developed some strategies to support the research enterprise. And the last time I presented, we shared a plan to reorganize the research office and move the graduate school into the office. And so today I'd like to share some of the important outcomes of this move and our current strategies and the priorities we've set for this coming year. Okay, so as all of you know, we are the land grant and the sea grant university for our system. And so we have this tripartite mission for research, teaching, and outreach. And as the flagship university of the system, we've built this infrastructure, you know, since the founding of the university for research. So we have this research infrastructure that we've been building over the past 150 years. And so, and this is also one of the reasons why we have this distinction in this One University plan. The distinction for our university is that we are the research and graduate studies university of the system. And we're the primary PhD granting institution of the state. Okay. So, but why are we doing research? And why do we have the graduate programs here at the university? And this is just a snapshot of undergraduate research and scholarship here at the University of Maine. And these data were provided by Dr. Ali Abedi, who's the director of the Center for Undergraduate Research. And since the inception of that center, and I don't know if you can see it here, if the podium is in the way, I can move this over. Help me move this over here. But since its inception in 2010, the number of undergraduates involved in the center, involved in undergraduate research and scholarship, has more than tripled, so that we have almost 250 undergraduates involved in undergraduate research and scholarship through the center. And the number of units, academic units, involved in this undergraduate research and scholarship is really impressive. Okay, so we're talking about, you know, so performing arts, political science, animal science, biology, anthropology, engineering. It's pretty amazing and pretty impressive. And having this kind of breadth of research and scholarship really comes from the fact that we have a graduate student network and also fantastic faculty who can mentor the graduate students and the undergraduates to undertake this research and scholarship. And so a university like the University of Maine is a place that we can do this. And I really don't think that some of the smaller liberal arts colleges in the state could do this kind of undergraduate research. Okay. So wanted to now give you a snapshot of how we are doing in terms of research. As was mentioned, we reorganized the offices of research and the graduate school. And in doing so, we have Scott Delcourt as the Senior Associate Dean of the Graduate School, and David Nevand as Associate Vice President for Research and Graduate Studies. We've also created the Office of Grant Development with Jason Sharlin. And just to remind everyone, this office was created in response to what was identified by the faculty in a survey that was generated by Faculty Senate in 2012. So from that survey, the faculty expressed a need for support in grant writing and grant development. So that's why this office was developed. So 2015 was a good year. The number of proposals submitted, down a little bit, but numbers of awards received, up. And proposal success rate is pretty amazing. It's a 76% success rate. And that's up from the year before in 2014, from 63%, again, to 76%, a phenomenal success rate. So it follows that if we can get the number of proposals submitted up, we should be able to increase the total support from external sponsors also up from more than 51 million, which is an impressive number. So that overall, we are up from our 2013 number, and we're holding steady at above 51 million. We're consistently ranked among the top 125 public universities by the NSF HERD report, and we are in our Carnegie designation. We're ranked as high research activity. We've also had major changes in our EPSCoR office. So we hired a new EPSCoR director, Shane Moikens. And Shane comes from the private sector and is coming to us with lots of new and innovative ideas. We are finishing up the last year of a Track 2 grant. This is a $3 million grant in collaboration with University of New Hampshire. And we just received, actually, a second Track 2 grant, also with University of New Hampshire and University of Rhode Island. And also in this, the last time you had an update in research, we also received a new Track 1 grant, which is a five-year grant for $20 million. So this is keeping our EPSCoR office very busy. And it includes, it's a multi-institutional grant, and includes these other institutions as our partners. Our primary partner is University of New England, right here. So, okay. Another research update is the Research Reinvestment Fund. This is a system-wide initiative, and the purpose of these monies were to strengthen research and development activities that are tied to Maine businesses and to industries that are critical to Maine. And the Board of Trustees committed $10.5 million over 5 years, and these monies are coming from savings that were realized from administrative review. And what does that mean, the administrative review? This is from consolidation of shared services, so things like IT, human resources as examples. And so this means that they're $2.1 million per year for these 5 years. And so how are these monies being used? So there's the seed grant initiative on the order of $50,000 to $100,000 for collaborative grants across the UMaine system for projects. And recently, 10 multidisciplinary awards were awarded for a total of about $850,000. And these projects are expected to, the groups are expected to submit federal, state, or commercial proposals by November of 2017. A second round is anticipated, or the deadline is March 21st of next year. They're also planning grants. So $50,000 were set aside from this fund, and those grants are on the order of $5,000 each. And the purpose of these grants is for groups to meet and plan in thematic areas. Okay, so because these are grants for groups across the system to collaborate, it was decided that groups need to form as well, and so funds needed to be set aside so the groups can come together and start to plan and develop as groups. There are also funds for graduate assistants. And so these are for groups that have projects, again, across the UMaine system, and to fund graduate students who would be supported to work on these projects that are collaborative projects. It would support the students for 1 year at a stipend level of $20,000. And then the PI, or one of the PIs in the grant, would cover the tuition and 50% of the health insurance. And the deadline for these proposals is January 4th. The assistantship would begin this next academic year. Provost Hecker talked about in the last faculty forum, which was last October, about the signature and emerging areas of excellence. And just to remind everyone, the areas, the signature areas and the emerging areas that were developed. And just as resources become available, including graduate lines, they will be reinvested in these areas, the signature and emerging areas. And I'll be discussing this as we continue with this presentation. Okay. And then April 21st, we had an event at the Collins Center celebrating scholarship. And we were able to honor more than 80 faculty from 28 different academic units. And featuring, is that waving or is it just, okay, it's not just me then. highlighting the scholarship of faculty from 2011 to 2014 and included research, books, visual, and performing arts. And I don't know how many of you were able to attend, but it was really impressive, the work that was on display and that was honored at that event. Okay. So I'm going to transition now to discuss some of the new initiatives through research and the graduate school. And just for the sake of time, I'm just going to be talking about two in particular. So the first is to increase grad funding to $55 million by FY18, and also to increase grad enrollment. Okay, so the first, to increase grant funding to $55 million by FY18. And so this was a priority set by the Board of Trustees. There's a benchmark that was set by the Board of Trustees. And okay, so how are we going to get there, and what assets do we have, strengths that we have? We have excellent faculty who are active in research, and we have strong research infrastructure. Again, as the flagship and as the land grant, we've been developing this infrastructure. We've identified signature and emerging areas so that we can really focus and on these areas and leverage in these areas. High quality graduate school and graduate students. And we've also reorganized so that research and graduate studies are together and that we can take advantage of the synergies between research and graduate studies. What are the challenges? Faculty attrition. So this impacts both proposal submission and research productivity. Many of the faculty have very high undergraduate teaching loads, and this, of course, impacts research productivity. And federal funding is becoming much more competitive and difficult to obtain. So what are some initiatives that we have underway to try to increase the grant funding? So one is to return indirects. So this is to incentivize faculty who are submit grants and perform research. Over the years, there have been a number of proposals for indirect cost return. And I'm sure there are a number of you sitting in this room who have been on these committees or who have led these efforts to try to work on indirect cost returns coming back to faculty who are research active. Okay, so and these indirect costs that are generated from federal grant dollars, these IDCs would be returned to faculty, departments, colleges, et cetera, in different percentages going back. Currently, $8.3 million of it is used to fill a structural gap in the budget. And so right now, the plan is that in FY17, $500,000 of this money will be returned to faculty who are generating this IDC from their grants. Okay, it's a small amount, but those faculty will be receiving IDCs back, and proportional to what they're generating in IDCs. In the future, what we're hoping is that an amount over the $8.3 million will be returned. How that will be returned we're still discussing. So in other words, how much will go back to colleges, departments, centers, et cetera, and to the faculty over and above that $500K. Okay? So I'd like to keep that $500K in there so that no matter how much we're bringing back in IDCs, we'll go back to the faculty. And then anything above that $8.3 million would also go back, and then again, we need to discuss how that would be going back. Another strategy, Grant Development Office. So the Grant Development Office, again, just to remind everyone, was created in response to faculty requesting more support for grant support, helping with developing budgets, helping with identifying funding opportunities, et cetera. And so the Grant Development Office is going to assist faculty, or does assist faculty, with proposal development, with resubmission strategies, identifying funding opportunities, and grantsmanship training. But we do understand, too, that office does have to prioritize, okay, because they're getting lots and lots of requests. So in order to prioritize, they are first prioritizing the signature and emerging areas, They're prioritizing when faculty are submitting grants, once they get the reviews of their grants, helping with resubmission. For the junior faculty, so the new faculty who are starting here at the University of Maine, to help new faculty navigate submitting grants and grant support. And also the large multi-investigator grants. So I mentioned EPSCoR, where it's multi-institutional, multi-investigator, so those types of grants. And the COBRI mechanism is the NIH version of EPSCoR. Okay, so as examples of these large multi-institutional, multi-investigator grants. Another strategy is new graduate assistants. And as I mentioned, as new resources become available, I would like to invest in graduate assistantships. I think this is a great way to help with really helping increase grant funding and moving the needle toward $55 million. So the graduate students not only can help on the teaching side in terms of helping in the classroom, in the laboratory for teaching, but also as this frees up faculty on the teaching side, also graduate students are research multipliers and can help on the research side as well. So I think that graduate students are a great investment. And I already discussed the research reinvestment funds, but also the university has contract with Coca-Cola. And from those contracts, there are funds coming in, and those funds are going to be invested in graduate assistantships. And those graduate assistantships right now are being targeted to signature and emerging areas. And so they're being distributed to those areas. Another strategy are shared technicians, and this can be a cost savings for units and laboratories, centers as well. So what we want to do is develop a pool of technicians. And this would be available to the campus community and individual faculty, centers, et cetera. And it would be these technicians would be charged from the pool and provided access on an as-need basis. So what do I mean by technicians, though? I would encourage you to think more broadly rather than some high-end, specialty trained individuals, such as an analytical chemist or an electron microscopist, but more thinking of someone who has expertise in, say, business development, accounting, statistical analysis, thinking more broadly. Okay? So if you have someone in your area who you can only fund a third of their time now, half time, to please contact Shane Moinkins, who is standing up there in the back of the room. He is EPSCoR director, but also is going to be in charge of this shared technicians pool. And he's going to be coordinating this effort of shared technicians and hopefully to retain our very, very good employees to cover the time for people who we want to retain here at the university. Another strategy is bringing more research faculty to our campus. So research faculty, especially for particular fields, such as marine sciences or environmental sciences, this is more of a traditional career where rather than having tenure track, you would be doing research, and it's a soft money position. So these appointments do not carry tenure, but they do have obligations to cover your own salaries. And it offers the potential for enhancing the future in research. And what these faculty appointments would hold 9 months faculty appointments. And if the faculty member is 100% soft money, 25% of indirects from their grants would go back to that investigator. Okay? And when you compare the 25% return of IDC, that's very generous compared to other universities. So many other universities, IDC is going back to soft money faculty is more on the order of 10%, 15%. So we feel like we will be very competitive. These faculty want to come to the university to work with our nationally, internationally renowned faculty in particular disciplines. So anyway, this is a way to expand the number of research faculty we have on campus. Okay, our second initiative is increase graduate enrollment. Strengths include this reorganization of research and graduate studies. We have an improved relationship and more collaboration with our Vice President for Enrollment Management, that's Joel Winkowski. Also more collaboration with international programs, undergraduate admission, and Division of Lifelong Learning. We have the online master's and certificate programs for working professionals at a discounted tuition rate. So the challenges, we have very few resources for marketing and recruitment for graduate students. And because of the decentralized nature of how our graduate program, graduate admissions are run here at the university, it presents challenges for communications and timely decision making. Okay? We need to move that timetable up. And increased competition in revenue generating professional programs is fierce, and competition in international student market is very fierce. So, strategy, streamline prospect communication. So using a CRM management system, and this is an automated system to send targeted communication to prospective students. Okay, this is a common automated system for undergraduate admissions, and we're using this now for graduate admissions. In terms of websites, we're developing recruitment-centric information aligned to the graduate school template is going to be aligned to this, and we're helping the departments make recruitment-centric updates to their program web pages. In terms of departmental communications, we're working with departments to develop consistent communication timeframes for inquiries, and we're working also to shorten the decision-making timelines, to move those decisions up so we can be more competitive. Strategies for direct marketing. Okay, so name buys. So we last year worked with an external company, so Royale, to do this kind of direct marketing. And we feel like, learning from the experience with Royale, they were able to increase our applications. So our applications tripled. That's great. The problem is that next step, the conversion from applications to actual bodies here at the university, that conversion never happened. Okay? We did, though, an internal control. So Scott Delcourt led an effort to do kind of an internal experiment in communication science disorder. So he did the same kind of thing, the name buying and kind of aggressively targeting students for CSD, and got the same kind of results. Tripled the number of applications. But the difference was, so it was interesting, Royale waived the application fee. Scott did not for CSD. Still tripled the number of applications, but then he got the conversion, right? Got tons of people really applying and wanting to come to the university. Royale got lots of applications, no one really actually applying and coming here, okay? So from that experience, we feel like we can do this direct marketing ourselves. Okay, so we learned from this experience. We feel like we can make just as good of a of an effort in the direct marketing and getting those applications, but we can also do the conversion. So name buys, so we're buying the names of potential students from targeted majors and demographics, and they will receive direct email and mailing blasts. For systems outreach, juniors and seniors across the system will receive direct mail and email blasts. For alumni outreach, alumni will get email blasts about graduate programs that match their undergraduate programs. And using LinkedIn data, we're going to reach out to our international alumni and invite them to reconnect with the graduate school so that we can build more of an international pipeline. And then tabling events, we're going to continue with providing tabling and on-site admissions counseling to graduate school fairs in the Northeast. International initiatives, we're going to outsource the contracting with agents and recruitment firms to outsource the international recruitment, increase participation in the conferences and seminars, and access admission pipelines and targeted markets for the international recruitment. Okay, so we're going to continue to assess the current and competing 4+1s to identify gaps and opportunities. For dual degrees, we're going to continue to support the departments as they develop these dual degree options. And then for online, continue to support the departments and UMaine Online as they develop these distance education options. Okay, so shared teaching assistants. So what is this? If you think about TAs as having two halves, one half is the teaching component and one half is the research component. And the motivation in thinking about this is to enhance the graduate student experience. We want the graduate student to have the best experience possible and the most options possible. Okay, so we'll give you an example. And also, we don't want to disrupt the teaching for the departments, especially for the departments who really have to worry about covering the large undergraduate classes, like Bio 100, okay, as an example. So if you have a teaching assistantship in Bio 100, as an example, if you uncouple that TA and the teaching portion of that TA stays in biology, the research half of that TA, the student now has the option of considering all the faculty in the biology department to do their research, but they also could consider, for instance, faculty in physics and maybe do biophysics as a research project or for their research, or chemical and biological engineering or microbiology or math because they're doing biological modeling or whatever discipline. As long as the faculty member is research active, and they'll compete for that research portion of the student's research half of their TA. And it matches with what the student would like to do for the research. Okay? So primary is that the student's experience is a really good one, and the student has more option for the research portion of the research half of the TA. And then the UMaine system doctoral teaching fellows. So as all of us know, the doctoral students, if they are interested in careers in academia, they will be more competitive if they have experience in teaching, classroom teaching. And so but they may want to be in a setting that's not like the University of Maine, in a research university, but they may want to be in a smaller college, university, more like Farmington or Presque Isle or Fort Kent. And so in a program that would be more of an expansion of the Susan J. Hunter teaching fellowships, they would have the option, and this is proposed, an option to do their teaching at one of the other system campuses. And what this would do would be to help the other university campuses find adequate replacements as their faculty go on sabbatical. And it would provide opportunities for our doctoral students to have opportunities to teach in a different kind of university setting. So this is proposed, and I'd love feedback from faculty about this and the students. This also, how does this help with increasing graduate students? So this would also open up potentially a pipeline. As students go to these other campuses and teach, they're also interacting with students at these other campuses, developing a relationship and potentially a pipeline to let these other students know about graduate education and potentially recruit some of the students from the other campuses to come here to the University of Maine. Okay, so switching gears one more time, and just to tee up Jeff's One University update. I hope that all of you have heard about the aging initiative for this campus. Yeah. Anyway, so the past year and a half or so, I've been talking about the aging initiative, interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary initiative for this campus. And I think it's been pretty successful and pretty exciting for me, at least, and for the faculty who have been actively involved. And thinking about the potential for our campus to be in this one university plan, and what does this mean in terms of research? And research has kind of been flying under the radar, right? So thought, well, why not see with this initiative how it would work across the system? So David Nevant and I spent last semester visiting the other campuses and reaching out to the other campuses and asking them, how would you like to collaborate with us on this aging initiative? And talk to the provosts and the presidents at each of the other universities in the system, and also meeting with faculty groups at each of the other campuses. And they were very, very excited because it's very inclusive. And each of the other universities had faculty who could plug in to this initiative. And so they were actually asking me, could we all meet together? And so we did. August 25th, we met at Wells Conference Center. All campuses were represented, so we had all seven campuses there. We had more than 100 participants. All seven campuses presented. We had speakers from the Maine Humanities Council, from the Machias, the county, I can't remember, the Washington County manager was presented, and it was great. It was a great discussion. We had discussion groups and breakout sessions, and what we're doing now is continuing with that effort. Lots of excitement, lots of momentum, and we hope to continue this. So, and in fact, Augusta is so excited about it. They're starting their own aging initiative on their campus. So, anyway. Before I turn this over to Jeff, just wanted to show everyone a research video. So I talked about this, the greater collaboration with enrollment management and Joel Winkowski. He's been great to work with. And he has been working with, you've seen those videos or the commercials, Define Tomorrow commercials. So that same company also developed a research video. And so this is a rough cut, very rough, but I'm going to share this with you now, but it's great. And it's only going to get better as they make this. Let's see, full screen.
Our students aren't just engaged in an academic endeavor. Their class projects are actually resulting in data that managers are using to better take care of our coasts and estuaries.
My research program is looking at deep water animals. So I'm a deep sea biologist, deep sea ecologist. My research program is all over the world. So at the moment I have projects down in the Antarctic, up in the Arctic, in Alaska, in the Galapagos, all over the place.
As a land-grant university, we provide a service to the state to provide knowledge for questions that stakeholders have across the state. I take students out in the field during the semesters to learn birds and to watch how ecology works. And then during the summers, I hire students to come out and help me with research.
If we go to Mars someday, this technology is one of, I would say, the two most promising ones for actually being able to decelerate manned spacecraft going to Mars. And the University of Maine will play a small role in that someday by virtue of the work that we're doing here. Everybody involved in the project makes a significant contribution.
We have a brand new facility that's come online. It's a wind wave testing facility where we can test floating structures, including structures that are anchored, and ships, and subject them to wind and waves at the same time. This is a facility that's unique in the world, and students can come here to the University of Maine and have the opportunity to work in facilities like that.
We take students here from over 30 academic departments. They get paid to work in labs like this on research projects funded by federal agencies as well as companies from across the world.
In this facility, we have over 30,000 fish, and each lab kind of has their own row where we store our fish for our experiments. The ultimate outcome and hope and the goal of research in this facility is basically provide the knowledge for other researchers to design therapeutics for certain diseases.
Right now we're looking at cross-sections from local white pine trees and specifically trying to pick out a fungal infection that's occurred in the last couple of decades. We're trying to figure out when it occurred on the tree and also trying to figure out how much of an impact it had on the tree's growth. Timber and forest industry is huge in Maine, and so I feel like I'm giving back to the state and the local community, and my research project isn't just for science, but it's also for the state of Maine.
Well, the beauty of the university having Ritter Farm allows the faculty to engage with students both in the classroom, and we even have a classroom up here, but also in the experiential sense.
We have around 30 cows, 15 horses, and I started counting the sheep, but I fell asleep.
To veterinary schools in a number of places, including Cornell, University of Pennsylvania, Washington State University, and they do very well.
We're in the Fermi Lab.
That's a virtual environments and multimodal interaction lab.
What he said. And here we work on cutting-edge virtual and augmented reality technology.
And spatial information processing.
I promised him he could be in the interview.
For me, I like using it for research. My background is in psychology, so it's a great tool to kind of look at scenarios that you wouldn't normally want to look at in the real world.
Part of being a student here is getting a chance to go to places like Greenland or Antarctica to collect samples. Last summer we went to Greenland and we were stationed near the ice sheet. So we were able to jump on a helicopter and we flew out over the ice sheet where there's this land called Inuitak surrounded by ice because this is where climate is changing the quickest. So we want to be on the front lines and where that's happening.
The undergraduate program with marine science is just very focused on the students. They want you to get as much experience as you can, especially hands-on, and that really sets you up for studying in graduate school and even just going off into the field.
I'm working on a research project right now that has to do with the stress level of farm-raised salmon.
in the state of Maine. I looked around at a lot of schools and I found that the University of Maine had everything that I needed and everything that I wanted.
That might go somewhere that you wouldn't expect to find yourself because you learn more about yourself than you ever thought you could. For me, that place was the University of Maine.
Questions, comments, thoughts about anything that Carol's presented so far? I see the video again. Kathy.
Yeah. Well, I guess maybe my department and some of the humanities departments aren't typical. Sort of the focus of these new directions for graduate assistantships and across the system and teaching, you know, having a research assistantship one place or teaching assistantship one place and doing your research and your graduate program in another. But I know that in my department, a lot of humanities departments, you want to bring the students into your graduate program and you want to have them teaching in your program, and that those two are really tightly connected, and that, you know, sort of separating them between your graduate program at one place and you know, teaching learning research and another campus sort of would work at counter purposes.
So this is just one piece of trying to expand the graduate programs, but that doesn't mean that we're going to be doing this for all the graduate programs, certainly. And it doesn't fit for all graduate programs. So this is just for, so that particular initiative is, you're right, will only fit for some of the initiatives, so, and not all of them. You're right.
Yeah. Something you showed in the very beginning, the chart with the big pie chart.
Yes.
I didn't understand what the underlying metric was. What is it a percentage of? Is it dollars? Is it numbers of students?
The numbers of students who participated in the Cougar Showcase.
Oh.
Yes.
For the new GA competition, the 1 year appointments, is that, you mentioned that was available to people involved in projects that span the system campuses, is that correct? Okay.
Follow-up
question, does that mean that the student is co-advised by two faculty of two different institutions?
Yes. Yes.
Carol, I'm going to pick up on the video. Certainly, I think that the video, it does nicely what it does. However, I think it leaves a big part out of research that happens across this campus. Mm-hmm. If you look at the video, you think research happens in the sciences. And my question is, where are the social sciences, where are the humanities? And I know where they are, so it's somewhat a rhetorical question. But I ask that because I think that, you know, as we move forward, we all move forward or we all don't. And so I think that we need to carry the message that research happens across campus, not just in the places with fancy labs and with federal funded dollars, but that we're a research intensive university in all areas.
I agree. So. For this video, it's still a rough cut, and there's still room to put other things. You actually have a very fancy facility, and I'd be happy to have video inserted into some of the fancier facilities. The reality, though, is that as a video, you have to show something, and so sometimes it's easier to put those things in. But if people have suggestions to add things, I would love to add more. So any suggestions that can be brought forward, I would welcome them. So, yes, very much so. Yes?
One quick follow-up on that. Is this going to be just one ad, or will there be breakout of several, maybe different kinds of ads that emphasize sort of mission diversity around it?
So this is not an advertisement. This is a research video.
Awesome.
That is going to be used when we have open houses and things like that. Now, this is far too long for an advertisement.
That's right.
Yes.
Carol, you're thinking of the video. I know my students, when they want to know something, they look for videos first. Is there any thought for, you know, some work to get different programs who are looking to have more students? You're creating small videos? Because
yes.
I know our professional organization contacted me, and they want our students to make a 2 or 3 minute video
yes.
that will go into a national video that will help recruit. But I think it would be interesting to have that capability to those programs who wanted to do that.
Oh, most definitely. I agree with you. So marketing communication are very eager to partner with the different departments to develop these videos. And so if you look online, and we have a YouTube channel, I think, that has a series of videos. And so we welcome partnerships with the different units to develop more of those videos. That's actually what we would like to do. So I would encourage all of you to contact marketing communication to develop those videos, yes. Yes,
Dan. The system's aspiration to be one university, 8 administrations, and no faculty is fraught with paradox. On the one hand, we're going to distinguish ourselves as a research university graduate program. We're further going to distinguish ourselves as a STEM research and graduate program. And yet, as far as I know, we're still very much an undergraduate, tuition-driven institution. So how are we going to pay the bills?
I'm going to take it on Carol.
I defer to you.
Well, we're going to pay the bills. We are going to grow our undergraduate enrollment, or at least maintain it. I don't think, I think your quick synopsis summary of the once university it was entertaining, but not quite got the whole picture. I mean, we are very interested in you can be a STEM at an institution that focuses on the areas that we've identified as signature areas, all of which have healthy undergraduate enrollment, and that was part of the reason why they were identified as signature areas, actually all of them have healthy enrollment, but they play a significant role in undergraduate education. So it's kind of hard for me to respond because I don't think you kind of characterized it fairly.
Well, I think it's fair.
Well, of course you do. I'm not shocked to hear that, but I mean.
Well, I mean, faculty are dwindling. We're paying all the bills on the backs of adjuncts and graduate students. You know, the system boasts of having fewer faculty. They can cut faculty. They can cut programs. And so that's the way it's going to be. I mean, that's the only sign of how things are getting done. And yet we're going to grow things. We haven't grown the undergraduate student body at this university in the 40 years that I've been here. It's all been within 5 or 10% of itself. So what's going to be new? That's what I don't understand.
What's going to be new? Your question is pretty. Well, I haven't heard a question that said what's going to be new. In what? Narrow me a little bit there. Let me help you out here. Right?
We're putting all of our attention on graduate study and on STEM programs.
Okay. So they're robust
programs,
I don't agree with that premise.
But they're about half of our student body.
Okay. I don't agree with that premise that we're putting all our in graduate programs and STEM. We are, as we said we would when we started the whole process of identifying signature areas, giving those areas preference and as we look at resources. With respect to STEM education, we are putting, STEM spoke very broadly, we are putting more resources in there. In the last 7 years, we have 800 more students in one of the STEM areas than we did 7 years ago. That's the reality. Is that, you know, is that because of the way we prioritize things? Perhaps, but I don't think so. Look at national trends. We're doing great, where's Dana? We're doing great in our College of Engineering enrollment, and I'll give Dan Humphrey and his colleagues great credit for all the efforts that they put into it. But to balance that, I'll say, nationally, engineering enrollments are growing. So we are putting the money where the students are. And the reality is the enrollment in those areas have skyrocketed. Enrollment in the areas of the arts and humanities are dwindling. That we have to make tough decisions about where our resources go, and we're trying to serve the students. So I don't really agree with the premise that we're focused only on graduate education, or actually that we're only focused on STEM, but we are investing where our students are.
So are we hearing that?
Oh, Jeff, can I just have a follow-up question? I know that through the process, there's been the discussion also of adding a third area to the signature and emerging areas, that is the foundations or something that might fall into that. Can you give us an update on that? Because that might answer some of this question.
Yeah, I can give you an update, but it won't answer that. there are two parts to it. I mean, one piece is looking at, we have all these forums about that. We have discussion about what our foundational areas are. We agreed on, again, tying into a national effort to look at the LEAP areas as areas would be foci. What our focus is on right now is, there are two areas. Our focus on that more broadly now is in looking at assessing our outcomes. How are we doing in terms of helping students to achieve, undergraduate students, to achieve these foundational outcomes identified by LEAP area. Ryan Doerr is leading that effort. As you probably heard me talk about, we're part of a multi-state collaborative to develop ways to assess that. We have faculty involved in doing that. I see that as an important piece of this. How are we doing? Where are the areas where we are not doing so well? And to use that information to help guide where we're going to make investments. In the short run, we are making some investments, and they are in foundational areas. But as Dick will point out, so I'll get him ahead, those are going to be in math, chemistry, and physics, primarily. Because that's where we have the logjam of undergraduate students. That's where students but because of faculty attrition and other reasons, that's where students are getting stuck on their degree progress. So we intend to make in FY17 immediately some investments in those areas, which are our foundational. But our longer range plan is to tie it to the student learning outcomes. And look at what are we getting and how do we move forward to make investments to get those learning outcomes where they're supposed to be.
I think that's an important point because one of the issues I think that comes up as we worry about the broadness or lack thereof of our curriculum and the fact that excellence in liberal arts and social sciences, and including business as well, is difficult to maintain with adjuncts, that one of the concerns I think most professors would agree about is that if we are not excellent writers and analytical thinkers, which is the forte of the liberal arts, humanities, and social sciences, that would also lead to STEM graduates that may not be competitive. So I think, you know, we can all agree probably that it's not possible to have an excellent even STEM-focused university or engineering-focused university if we eventually go in that direction due to student demand, unless we make very high investment in those kinds of skills. And they can't be, Doug Gelinas back in the day said to me that, well, we could do it within the College of Engineering. We can have special courses that teach students technical writing and use the professors that we have. And I think everyone would agree nowadays, a decade later, that that's really not the level of excellence that we want to see. So I think it's important to emphasize that even if the students aren't majoring in those areas as much, that all of our students are benefiting from a full gen ed curriculum that reflects the highest level of accomplishment in writing and analytical thinking.
I completely agree. And again, as an example, one of our strategic investments this year under the heading of signature investments is in the English department for someone in professional and technical writing. Because we have strong people there, but we have high demand there coming from all over campus. And so that is one of the areas we're investing in this year.
And just to follow up, the GREs will reflect that. So I always tell my students that are very tech-oriented, math-oriented, computer-oriented, to read a D.H. Lawrence, which is all love affairs and romance and Victorian writing, but teaches them a very complex story development, language usage, and the kinds of things that you don't get in everyday textbooks. So I think that's where it's really critical to continue to focus our faculty investment in that area.
Do you mind if I interject? So Dylan Dreyer is leading a workshop series this year, and so I'll say this for the whole room. We're really looking for some folks that are interested in being part of really digging deeply into writing across the disciplines. And so email me and I will tell you all the details. So.
Other general questions before I tell you about what's happening in academic transformation?
I'd like to mention, so I think it was Brian who just spoke. A long time ago under Harvey Kale, we did do writing across the curriculum, and a lot of us participated in the 1980s, yeah. And so a lot of us are kind of still here who did that, and it was very useful, but it really was, you know, writing and critical thinking and peer evaluation, and it's the kind of thing that the English department inspired, and had a lot of the rest of us, not just in humanities, but I think probably mostly in humanities and social sciences that followed it and who continued a lot of those things we learned to this day.
Okay, let me run through just a few things about the One University. So I'm going to focus on the academic transformation piece of this. Excuse me. I do want to, before I forget, announce on Monday, a week from today, at 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock, Brian Lowe is going to have give a presentation about One University focused on the budget. As you know, by FY18, we're moving to a unified budget, and Ryan is going to talk through sort of this. He won't leave knowing exactly what that is. I've been to many meetings about it, but you'll know a little more about the process of trying to figure that out. And again, I encourage you to attend. Because it's an opportunity to have input into that process. But today I'm just going to talk about the academic transformation piece of the One University initiative. Some of this is a quick review of what's gone on so far, but just quickly to bring up people up to speed and then talk about a couple of things specifically. We did round one referring to last year. And these were the nine areas that were covered. Again, very quickly, these teams put together reports that were submitted the last day of May. There was work done on those over the summer, narrowed down to the recommendations that we wanted to move forward with. And I'll show you where we're at. There it is. Decided on what the recommendations that we wanted to move forward with. This fall, what we'd call implementation teams, which isn't necessarily the same groups that came together for round one discussions, because it really, who's going to implement followed from what kind of recommendations have come out. But they're moving forward. They all received a charge. The heads of those teams received a charge from the chancellor sometime in October, a letter saying, you know, go forward with these pieces of the, implement these recommendations. So that work is moving forward. The exact charge varied by area because of the recommendations varied quite a bit by area. But as an example, Dean Humphreys is leading the group looking at engineering across the campuses. Some of that work is looking at the campuses that don't offer any engineering and trying to help them to understand what they would need to do if they really wanted to have a 2+2 type program, what they'd have to do in terms of the core areas, and then what kind of engineering education they would do. I would say right now, Dana, it'd be fair to say it's about exploring the feasibility of that, whether that's a realistic thing to pursue. But there's discussions looking at that. And anyway, I won't run through them all because I can't remember them all. But there are, each area is slightly different in terms of the focus. And so who's leading it and how it's being carried out kind of varies with the mission. Round two are these areas. I mentioned again last time we talked. You'll notice that the first six of these seven areas we're thinking of as foundational, they play a foundational role in students' education. And the decision to focus primarily on these foundational areas came out of recommendations from round one, saying, look, it's not just our curriculum, but we would have to know that students know things in biology, chemistry, English, math, et cetera, if they're going to move in forward in our disciplines. So we brought forward these core or foundational areas to look. And their charge is slightly different. We're asking them to both look at their majors, but also to look at the kind of core foundational requirements in their areas. So in chemistry, for example, what are the campuses offering in Gen Chem, in organic, these kind of core areas. But again, the same overriding goals as the first round. That is, how can we increase accessibility to our programs through collaboration? How can we improve quality through collaboration? And how can we manage costs or do this in a financially sustainable manner? So that's the charge that's gone to these groups. In round two, oh, I'm sorry, I'll show you real quickly. These are the UMaine people participating in round two teams. I won't read them off, but that's for those areas, English and math, physics, psychology, and social work. I think that's it. These teams were launched on September 26th in a full-day meeting. They've had meetings, Google Hangout, usually type of meetings, or some other form of distance in between. There was a update meeting on November 13th for the teams to get together. And jump down to the last bullet point. Their reports are due on March 1st. And again, we anticipate that the kinds of recommendations will vary across the units. One thing I did want to show you is what happens, what we've done is, I think, a better job than round one of sort of thinking through what are the steps for review and what's the timeline for that to occur. And if you're bored sometime, I can tell you all the mistakes that we made the first round in terms of timing. But where we're at, the first steps are identifying one of the areas. We've done that. We're at step three now, which is the teams working working together. The idea is that the people who are on these teams are representative, so they should be going back and sharing information, gathering information from their home campuses, from their colleagues in their disciplines, and sharing information. So the idea is that there should be some kind of feedback loop between the team members and the people in their discipline and other academic stakeholders relative to their work. They have, as I said, until March 1st. Their reports are due on March 1st. And between March 1st and March 25th, the chief academic officers, the provosts from each campus, will review these with the team leaders. We'll review them ourselves. We'll review them with the team leaders, ask them questions, et cetera. We'll do a process, and likely, like last time, we'll take probably a larger set of recommendations and narrow that down to recommendations we feel that we can move forward with. What we'll do is on March 25th, we're going to post these set of more narrow recommendations as well as the feedback. Some of what we heard last time was, geez, we made this recommendation and then I don't see it. The team made this recommendation and I don't see it in the final ones. And that's a fair criticism. What we'll do is we'll post, these are the recommendations we're going forward with. Here are things we're not and why. either because we're delaying or because we don't think it's a good idea or whatever. We do want there to be continued opportunity for feedback. So between March 25th and, let's see, by April 22nd, we'll hope that people will read these and provide further input and thoughts and reactions to the recommendations. Then they'll go up and the chief academic officers will again review these, this time with the chancellor to make sure he's on board, and then the chancellor will move forward. We're giving ourselves to May 6th, so we have a pretty short window. Then it goes to the chancellor to move forward, give authority to groups to move forward with implementing the recommendations that we want to move forward with, if that makes sense to you. And the rest of it is mostly keeping people informed. Now, in terms of where we're going forward, we had thought about launching a round three this spring, and what the decision has been mean to postpone that for a while for two reasons. First, let me say we're going to postpone a round three. We're not going to go through and say, okay, here's the other disciplines we're going to look at. But we do want to say that any groups, any disciplines, any areas that say, gee, we would like to have some conversations. We think there's merit in our area. I talked to a department chair this morning that thought there might be some opportunities for collaboration with another campus around graduate enrollment, graduate education, that we're encouraging them to do that, and the system will provide some funding to help make, you know, to ease the pain of doing that, cover travel costs, et cetera. So we don't want to squelch anybody, but we're not going to charge units to go forward at this point in time for two reasons. The first is that we realize that in the first, we'll be getting the round two recommendations. The round one recommendations are still being worked on for implementation. And of course, as you might imagine, problems are emerging and is stumbling blocks. And there's some consistency across them. They often have to do with different bureaucracies colliding. We're trying to launch something now with the University of Southern Maine and University of Maine Farmington around Masters of Education in Information Information Technology and Instructional Technology, thank you. And everyone's on board, everyone wants it to happen, but we keep smashing into, technical, bureaucratic problems. We're working on trying to solve those. What we realize is we need to solve some of those problems before we go too much further. So that's one reason for delaying. And the second reason is that the system has invested in and already carried out or hired a company to come in and do some market studies to look at where we anticipate enrollment trends are, where the demands are for what kinds of programs. Those data are in, they are immense, and they need to be waded through. This January, the chief academic officers, myself and my colleagues from the other campuses, are going to meet for a day and a half to work through this and look at these data and have discussions about where are the areas that we can invest that will grow enrollment, whether they're on single campuses or through joint programs. What are the programs that we want to invest in? Or are there areas where we're already offering programs and there's potential for them to expand, but we are not expanding because we don't have the faculty resources or we don't have the space resources to do that? So we want to look at these market data and then use those to guide our decision making about what are the areas we want to focus on for round three. So I'm not going to give a date for the round three thing because we want these things to work out. I anticipate that conversation to start sometime in the spring semester. Probably we're looking at spring with the launch in the fall in terms of moving those forward. The other thing I wanted to take, since I have your attention, is a few minutes to talk about Unified Online. So Unified Online, for those of you who pay attention to these kind of things, there was a report, a system-wide report. The chancellor charged the president of the University of Maine at Augusta, they charged her, and Rosa Redonit, whose title is something like Senior Student Affairs Officer for the system, to develop a report making recommendations about how we can be more, how we can go about doing online education in a more unified way. The idea being to decrease competition between campuses that are posting the same kind of degree, potentially could post the same kind of degree programs online, and already are posting some courses online competing with one another. And two, to be thinking strategically about how we use online system-wide to reach for the people who have difficulty with accessibility, and of course to grow enrollment. For those of you who looked at it, it was a very detailed plan. It was a 68-page report. It had a an organizational chart that had lots of circles and squares in it, and but if you paid any attention to it, you notice it said hire a new person at an expensive salary. I think it was quoted at 175, I think, or something like that, for an associate vice chancellor for online education. And the other part that jumped out to a lot of folks is, hey, there seems to be decision making in this structural model that involves curriculum, and the faculty voices are not appropriately being heard. That report was put out for comment. We had a whopping 9 days to comment, but I want to thank the people, particularly on the Faculty Senate, who got together. Marie Hayes led this group, and who's you worked with closely?
Amy
Fried and Marie. And Amy and Marie led this, getting input, and they submitted a paper or a response, set of concerns, to the Board of Trustees, Academic and Student Affairs. I also want to commend the University of Maine Dean's Council, who did a similar thing in a short period of time, put together a few page, set of concerns about this. This went to the Academic and Student Affairs Committee. And the positive thing that came out of that was that, unlike what everyone expected, which was that they were going to endorse this report, they did not do that. So I actually put up verbatim the motion that passed by the Board of Trustees. With my apologies to them, there's one typo, that colon shouldn't be there. I think it was supposed to be a semicolon or a comma, but I did it in a hurry. But it is important to just look at this quickly. I'll read it. The Board of Trustees gives conceptual approval to the institutional collaboration model. And again, what that means is in the report, they talked about different models. One model they considered was setting up a whole nother, whether you call it the eighth or ninth university, that was going to be the online thing separate from all the other campuses. Fortunately, through discussion, they rejected that. They rejected a couple others, but they said they do want to, the report did recommend a collaboration model. So the Board of Trustees are saying they support that, but then the next piece is important. It says they're directing the chief academic officers to get input from the faculties of the campuses to provide recommendations so we can implement this in a way that process that honors campus-based shared governance for online programs. So I do want to say the faculty voice was heard. Now the onus of responsibility is on us to do that, to come forward with a proposal about how this could work. That does include the appropriate kinds of faculty oversight or faculty input and shared governance into issues around curriculum. What was the other thing I was going to say about that? Oh, in general, if you read that, right, and you're familiar with, boards and bureaucracies and institutions, I mean, basically what that says is we endorse the general idea of this report, but none of the specifics. And I think that's a good outcome. But there will be work that has to be done by next March on the specifics. Thursday of this week, I'll be going to a meeting with the chief academic officers. This is an agenda item. What's our plan for how to move this forward? Monique LaRocque, the head of our Division of Lifelong Learning, who I think is the most knowledgeable person in the University of Maine system and the state about these things, she and I will be meeting Wednesday just to go over some rough ideas that I can bring in. After that meeting, I'll be meeting with Marie Hayes, who's head of the Academic Affairs Committee for Faculty Senate, and we'll come up with a process to move this forward. But I did want to give the campus some feedback on that. I'm sorry, the other piece about this is this report that was developed, so we had this whole academic transformation discussion going on over here, and then they developed this unified online report over here, which several people, myself included, pointed out didn't make much sense. These two processes should be integrated. We should be using what we're learning for bringing these teams together to guide our thinking about how to use online, as opposed to coming up with a structure for online, then saying, oh gosh, we came up with these plans and they don't fit our structure. Go back to the drawing board. So we're trying to get that to be aligned in the correct way. To say, look, we're going to use what comes out of these discussions among the program integration teams to guide the way we look at using online. And I think that was the last thing I was going to talk about. It was. So, further questions or comments about any of that?
Can you show the flowchart number to the... I'm hearing rumors, but I guess about issues around 3 and 5, that I guess reports came from these teams and that they were rejected in some sense, and then some people rewrote parts of them. Do you know anything about that? Or?
So, let me clarify your question. Are you talking about what happened in round one?
Round one, yes.
Okay. So yes, some things were rejected. So these were meant to come forward as a set of recommendations. And I mean, I put it in a more polite way. We accepted some recommendations and others are tabled for further consideration. And the rewriting piece?
Yeah, I'm hearing that like some faculties are saying that didn't happen at the meeting we were at.
No, and they're right. They're right. And they're right. So what happened was, some of the reports came through. And the chief academic officers looked at it and said, gee, these look great for me to move these recommendations forward. Some we had serious concerns about, and we're not going to move forward. So we put together sort of a different set of recommendations, often, though, having to do with going back and revisiting some of the issues that were presented in the first report. Where we, you know, did not do a good job was in communication about this. I mean, this was decided in a meeting in June, and we all said, okay, we'll go back and tell, you know, we'll tell the team leaders from our campus about, no, I'm sorry, we were each assigned an area to tell them. I had engineering and mine was easy, so I just told Dana, your report looks good and they want to move forward. The other ones, there were the communication, it did not happen like it should. That's why we built this in, this idea that we would put out, when we post these responses, it'll say what we're moving forward with and it'll provide feedback on the other areas, and then people have an opportunity to respond to that. So, hopefully we'll address that in this one. Other questions? Peter.
Jeff, you had mentioned the system was doing or has done a market analysis or market study. Was that just in relation to where to go with round three disciplines?
No, it was much, much broader.
It can include, there may be information that would redirect round one or round two.
It was done completely independent of what happened in round one or two. It was a very, very broad reaching. I mean, it had a variety of methodologies, some not so good in my opinion, but some I think good. So they interviewed alums, they interviewed people who were accepted at our universities and went elsewhere. They looked at, you know, employment data. There's a variety, that's why I said it's a massive amount of data. It's looking at this from a variety of problems, but not specifically to say, you know, we ignore these things, we're gonna, because they were already done in round one and two. No, it's much, much broader. Yeah.
Well, did they ask prospective students how they felt about going to Presque Isle and taking their courses via internet from Maine, from Orono, or did they interview Orono students? Do you really want to come here and take all your gen eds from Fort Kent, because that's what we're going to do now?
I doubt they asked those specific questions.
Historical. You know, but when this was tried once before, and they were going to send umpy kids down to Machias and all the rest of it for some, they didn't go. It was a great administrative conception, and the students didn't want to go to Machias if they had enrolled in umpy. They had their reasons, whatever they were, they had them.
And that's why it's fortunate that that's not what's coming out of the program integration team. So far, out of the nine teams in round one, no one suggested what you're suggesting. So I'm not sure, again, I'm not sure how to respond. No one is suggesting that we bus kids from Presque Isle to Machias, or we accept them from Presque Isle and send them to Machias. You know, the reality is Presque Isle won't be able to offer all programs. My opinion is they'll have to shrink their menu of courses, but that's not the
we're going to have to shrink ours as well.
Yes, we are, yeah.
To phrase that slightly differently, the term program integration hasn't been very clear to me what, and I know it means different things for different programs, and you had some general statements about what that would mean, but could you put some more character to that so I have a better sense of what this is really trying to accomplish in its best sense as opposed to maybe the worst sense?
Yeah, I would say, unfortunately, maybe I couldn't change it. I missed the meeting when they came up with program integration team as the title, but, because I don't really think that captures it, because what it says is, I mean, that says to me is everybody's going to integrate, and that's really not the goal. If you look at the things that came out of round one, they were things like, building connections between undergraduate programs at some universities and other universities and our graduate programs, having discussions between those faculties to say, how can you better prepare your students and so they can move in, potentially developing 4+1 programs. They were around things like, I'll pick it because it was controversial and because I don't see any historians in here, but I might be wrong. So the history one was very controversial, and this was one where the faculty group said, this isn't what we recommend. That's one where we are asking the folks to go back and look. The reality is, you look at history, we have a history degree, USM has a history degree, I think Farmington has a history degree, but everybody teaches history, right? It's a good, Maurice Point, you got a good college, liberal arts-based college education. Well, we were asking those schools to look at how they can share resources. So how can University of Maine we have a solid, strong undergraduate curriculum in history, but as I've heard many times in my old job, and once in a while it gets up to me in my new job, we have areas we don't cover because we don't have enough faculty to cover those areas. Are there ways that we can say, okay, we will agree to offer some of our courses online so they're available to the other campuses, and they will offer some of their courses online. So a University of Maine student, can take primarily their curricula here, but can take a course that might be offered at University of Maine Farmington that covers areas that we don't know. What we didn't like about what came out of it was, what came out of the report was basically saying, the three campuses that have a degree, we're happy, but the four other campuses could go ahead and talk about creating a program together. And we didn't think that was a good use. That rather, why not have all seven campuses look at ways that they could do that? So a student could be potentially, if the team could come up with this, at University of Maine Presque Isle and start and maybe get enough to either transfer here, or potentially they could earn a degree by drawing courses from the other campuses. But that would be adding to something that Presque Isle doesn't offer already, and it would be trying to complement what we do. But I'll answer your question more succinctly than I would imagine. More succinctly, again, it goes back to those three goals. How do we increase accessibility to our programs, both in terms of growing enrollment, system-wide, and in terms of sharing faculty expertise. And two, the second thing is the quality thing. And again, I've heard from many people, not just Professor Ruscher, but we're tearing apart quality by making students take courses online. I'd like to think that's not necessarily the case. I think we can raise quality, again, by saying we can't afford right now at this point in time to invest all the people we should in history at the University of Maine. That's just a reality of it. Are there ways we can improve the quality of the undergraduate program by making it easier for students at UMaine to access some of their courses at the other campuses? To me, that would be a good outcome of program integration in history, using that example.
If I could continue with the same example, there's a great danger there. And one of the things we're discussing in the mathematics group presently is this idea of offering things on some campuses available through streaming them to other campuses and so on. The danger, though, is that by offering things, say, at Farmington that we don't regularly offer here, we drain off some of our seniors who will now take those courses and in consequence make some of our 400-level courses not viable. Mm-hmm. Because there is a fixed pool of people here on campus. If they're going to divide their attendance and share some of that to campuses which presently only have extremely small classes, they will offer more 400-level classes and it will come at our cost.
Right.
And there's a great danger there that instead of being able to concentrate the resources in a flagship university, we end up essentially, again, supporting the branch campuses, which are not really viable in this form.
And I agree with that as well. And again, that's why you're on the committee and not me at those discussions. I don't understand the level of detail of that. You do. So, again, what I outlined for history, you know, I meant it as an exemplar. I'm not saying that that has to be all things, and that's why, again, we need a voice like yours at the table saying, this sounds great, men and women of our team, but we can't afford it. What can we do? Again, I think in math, for example, I don't control everything, but what I think, they could create opportunities where students could start somewhere, and if they really want to get a math degree, then they transfer here, wherever they could get a math degree. But we want to have that kind of integration where they don't have to start over at the University of Maine to get a math degree, but they would have some...
But we already have that. We don't need this program integration for that.
I don't agree with you, because I don't think you are confident that their students are getting the courses that they need to be able to come here and finish in 4 years. And you're right, we have that. But I think if we can look at what they have, and again, look at how do we assure that the student learning outcomes for these lower level courses are the same, we'll make it easier for students to move between these campuses.
I agree that the question of the student outcomes of the lower level courses is something that should be viable, yeah. And it should be viable across most of the disciplines.
Right.
That seems to be a pretty low hanging fruit that we should be able to get out of this process. My main concern, though, is with the parts of the offerings we give here right now, which are borderline sustainable. But we only just managed to do it. We're short of tenure stream faculty. That is one of the reasons why our 400 offerings have diminished over the last years. And yet, if we are not careful, those other campuses, which are in worse shape than we are, will end up cherry picking some of our seniors, making the rest of our activities difficult to sustain. And in the long run, that's got to be a losing game, because we all end up diluting our resources.
I agree, if it ends up that way. I agree. I'm repeating myself, but that's why we want to be in part of this, into this discussion with them. So we try to do this in an intelligent way, not just say, I haven't heard anyone say, program integration means everyone puts their courses online. That's not what we're about. That's not what most of the other campuses are about, although some are moving that way. We need to be able to meet our mission. And again, if you're telling me we can't offer them 400 level courses, I'll probably say to you, show me the data, and if you convince me, or you convince your dean, and then she comes and convinces me, then I'll be the one down there saying, sorry, we can't do this.
Perhaps I wasn't clear. We can certainly offer them 400 level courses.
No, you are being clear what I mean, without harming ourselves.
No, we can offer 400 level courses, and we can offer space in the ones we presently offer to those campuses. Yeah. But from their perspective, it leaves the few 400 level courses that they do offer, say once every 2 years, not viable if we're poaching some of their students. And by the same token, some that we offer presently will not be viable because students might prefer to take something else that we don't offer. It's a two-edged sword here that's very dangerous, and the discussion in the group presently is difficult because we are basically the only campus where our 400 level courses, for the most part, have a minimum number of students.
Yeah.
And this makes me sort of like the little Dutch boy with his finger in the dark.
I think you said in response to Dick that Presque Isle will see their programs diluted. You also, UMaine will see a number, our portfolio also. Yeah. Can you say some more about how our portfolio, not in specifics, but scenarios?
I'm reluctant because I don't know. This is part, so this academic transformation, supposed to have different components to it. So one component is unified online, how do we get them? The other component is what we're doing here with this, what we're calling program integration teams. The third component is what they're calling portfolio review. Right? We're looking at what is the portfolio programs offered on our campus, and what are the portfolios on other campuses, and saying what do we stop offering, and what do we do? And I've been in these meetings for two years and 3 months, and we've been talking about this, and no one's yet come forward to say, here's what we're gonna do. Now, this was a good thing. I actually suggest we on this Thursday have to make that part of the agenda, not doing it, but developing a plan of how do we go about it. From my point of view, what we need to do is lay out what are our criteria, right? So ours now being the whole system. Where's the enrollment? Where are their students going? We have the data, and I've shared it with them to show that if we decide, we're not offering physics here anymore because we decided, pick a campus, Presque Isle is going to be the physics campus. I've shown them the data that say that's going to be a net drop in enrollment for University of Maine system. Students come here to study with you, Jim. You should also know they come because they want to come to a flagship land-grant university. If they don't come here, they can go to UConn, URI, UNH. So I showed them those data over and over. That's, you know, but that is got to be a part of this discussion. From my point of view, it should be all about enrollment, because it's all about how we're going to pay the bills. And again, this is obviously, you're getting a humane-centric perspective, but to me, it's obvious there are some of these. Well, I'll look at Nigel. They offer a math degree at University of Maine Presque Isle, and they have one faculty member. To me, that's an obvious way that you should say, here's a way to narrow things. And I don't know what the enrollment is, but I suspect it's very small. To look that way. Well, that mean, you know, and the chancellor said this to me in response, UMaine can't have everything. You know, when I respond, say, well, why not? We're a comprehensive university. We're a research university. You know, show me, you know, what are the areas we shouldn't be doing that don't fit with our mission and don't help us with enrollment? And, you know, if we can find those areas, we'll have a discussion about it. I'm not seeing that. So, anyway, it's a long answer to say, one, the issue is being avoided, and two, I am pushing for it. We do it in a way where we're very public about criteria. We say, this is it, you know, enrollment. Because otherwise, this will not surprise you, again, just give me my opinion. It'll be which one does Farmington get? Which one does Machias get? Well, they haven't got one yet. Why don't they get that one? And we'll all watch enrollment with another tube. So I, you know, I'm not going to sit there and say, oh, that's a good idea. I'm just being there making my points.
Yeah. This is a quick question when you mentioned this, because this has been in my imagination a little bit too. In the logic that you would start to divvy up programs like Easter egg candy, you know, like or Easter candy, like you get some, you get some. Is there a discussion that students don't go to college that way?
Yeah.
And so then, why did this idea come up?
Oh, I think the idea has less strength than it used to, but I think it's valuable to do this portfolio review, to be frank, because I think many of our sister campuses are just way, they're a mile wide and a half an inch deep. They offer all these programs, they have faculty members, they have programs with only adjunct faculty members. They have, I mean, you know, so again, that would be another criteria. Let's look at enrollment, let's look at faculty strength, let's look at faculty quality. Here's some reasonable criteria if we have to make decisions about where programs should rest. And if we do it in that way, in a very public way like that, and with, you know, criteria that are published, I don't think University of Maine is going to be hurting very much. That's my take.
I'm sorry to state the obvious, and I know I'm not the only one, but it seems like UNO campus is being cannibalized so that they can keep the system going. And, you know, it sounds like the system isn't viable. And so rather than just saying the system isn't working, let's like rethink that. They're going to take all the campuses down, and there's going to be nothing left that's viable. And it just doesn't make any sense in the larger picture of things.
I have a hard time disagreeing with you.
That's
a good point. I mean, you know, I agree to take this job. I'm doing it.
I'm not criticizing.
No. My point is, you know, I'm going to go in there and try to argue so that doesn't occur. But you're right. I mean, we are at risk of you know, when things get centralized, it's going down to, you know,
right,
common denominator. You know, my point is, I'm going to try my best, and I'm going to hope we can work together with the faculty to prevent that. It doesn't serve, you know, not only about our university. It's not good for our state. It's not good for the students. It's not good for the taxpayers to do that. So, my point being, it's three.
So, is the purpose this, the faculty think it is, to reduce the number of human resource costs, such as faculty? So, in other words, is the whole idea to reduce costs through human resources and to focus it on faculty? Because that's the way it feels to us looking at it.
So I'm going to ask you a question for a question. Whose idea? When you say, is that the idea?
So the idea, I would say the chancellor's vision.
I would say, from my conversations with the chancellor and board of trustee members, that yes, many board of trustee members say we have too many human resources around the entire system, and to be viable, we need to shrink our human resources. So I think that is part of the I mean, you look at what they did with the administrative reviews, right? We have fewer people in IT. You know, we have more service, but we have fewer people, and we've saved some money. We have fewer people in human resources. We're getting more service, but we have saved some money. I can't with a straight face tell you, no, I don't think that's the plan. I do think that's the plan. And again, from my point of view, our job is to say, if you're going to do that, you know, let's do it intelligently. Let's follow where the quality of faculty is. Let's follow where the research dollars are coming in. Let's follow where the students are going. Let's do it in an intelligent way, not a political way. And the politics aren't always not intelligent with them.
In the case of languages, most of what was recommended was tabled or set aside. So I'm left wondering, is there any overlap between the program integration process and the other branch of program or portfolio review? Especially given that the chancellor publicly stated that no language department within the system is viable.
Yeah, so I'm not really sure.
We did.
I'm not sure about your question. Is that? Is that getting more
screen? Our language department's going to get cut following the portfolio.
I don't know. But I mean, what I would say is that no, there has not been a discussion to say let's go to the language department. What we know, the reality is, and I know you're very aware of this, the language faculties on this campus and every other campus have shrunk. How many years we want to go back, but they've all shrunk. As has demand for the major, and as has demand for the coursework. That's for a whole variety of reasons. But the demand has really gone down. It's very difficult to say we want to invest in faculty lines. I think where the system is really looking is the recommendation that did come out of round one that you know survived, if you will, which was this is an area where I do think a degree that draws on the resources from multiple campuses is the best way to preserve a quality French degree or a quality Spanish degree. We already narrowed the universe to two languages, which is kind of crazy, but that's what we've done. The focus and the discussion is on that, Jane, and not let's lob up. Because we know, you know, we close languages at University of Maine, all it does is just reduce enrollment. We close languages at USM because they're already very small, right? And all you can do is not save very much money and lose some students, not tons, but you lose some. And I think instead they want to be able to offer languages through its collaboration. I mean, from my point of view, languages is a good example of why program integration and collaboration amongst the system campuses is a good idea. I think it's a good example because of those problems with enrollment and demand. Other questions? All right, well, once again, Sergeant.
Literacy, it almost seems like that's where we're going to, that's almost the attractor for this, is that we're all going to end up unviable, in fact, maybe almost the Nigel point. So essentially, through other reasons that happen for languages, at some point we're sharing, and it's like, well, let's just keep cutting. Well, it seems like we will never have an institution anymore is the end game.
I don't think that's the end game.
It's where we may inadvertently end up.
I agree. I'm very worried. I'm very worried. I don't, you know, again, I'm not doing what I can, but I don't think, you know, I don't think that is where we'll end up, but I'm worried about it as well. And again, we have to look at, you know, go back to an earlier discussion. That's another reason why we need to invest where the students are going at this point in time. We got to make sure we're providing them good quality, and we're not going to collapse in. Anyway, thank you all again. I hope again that the chancellor doesn't watch these when we post them, but this will be posted. This will be posted within a few days, your board, and so will the PowerPoints.